Hello, we're here at Rochester with the Rochester Super 8. I'm Chad Morgan along with head coach Clint Gard for the Rochester wrestling team. And as you see, a match in progress already is Braxton Lee versus Aaron Heller of Tippecanoe Valley. And
Braxton hits a nice front headlock there to an ankle pick. Didn't quite finish it though. Giving up our leg. Braxton's doing a nice job of continuing to wrestle. And puts Heller on his far hip and gets a score out of it. Gets a Turk in, and now we're getting some back points. Right there, Braxton's got to, he's got to get out 90 and keep his hips down and his head up a little bit better and not like let Heller roll through on that.
At this time right now, the score is 4-2 in favor of Braxton. This is the second match that these guys have wrestled this year, and the first came victor to Braxton by fall in 2 minutes and 53 seconds.
That was at the John McKee, right?
That was at the John McKee Memorial, where Braxton placed second place out of a 16-team tournament. Rochester actually won that tournament for the first time since 2005, narrowly edging out Plymouth for the title. The situation we're here today is Rochester's wrestling 5 different dual matches where it's actually individual and your team, you score team points based on how you win, such as you can win by decision, you can win by a major decision, you can win by technical fall and a fall. And team points that you score is by a decision is a 1-point victory to a 7-point victory. You score 3 points for the team. Then you go into trying to score bonus points for your team, such as the major decision is an 8-point to a 14-point victory. Then you go into the technical fall, whereas if you score more than 15 points than your opponent, they just stop the match and award the victory to the person in the lead. And then you get a fall, which is where you hold your opponent's shoulders down for a 2-second count. And we're still at, the score is still 4-2 in the first period.
Braxton hits a nice stand up there, gets to his feet. Got to break our lock, got to sit down in your chair a little bit. And end up back on the mat. Heller's running what they call an arm bar, a shoulder lever. Some people old school call it a billy goat ride. You've got your forehead in the back of your shoulder.
Tippecanoe Valley coming into this duel against Rochester, placed third at the John McKee Memorial. Braxton gets a quick reversal and has Heller on his back.
Yeah, it's a nice Granby roll there, got his hips cleared out. Nice Granby roll, gets a reversal, and Heller is on his back with a 3-point near fall, and looks like we're going to pick up the fall here.
And he gets the fall, putting Rochester up 6-0 after the first match. Some people may be a little confused on why this match started at 152 pounds. A few years ago, the IHSA came up with a rule to maybe increase the excitement of a duel. Instead of starting everything at the lowest weight class and working your way through the heaviest, they do a blind draw on what weight it might start, because it actually changes the philosophy, or maybe the way you are going to work through a duel when you start at a different weight other than your lightest weight class.
Right, you may not move people around like you would, or you may be able to move people around.
So currently up on the mat right now, you have Tyler Downauer, who just hit a nice low double, driving his Tippecanoe Valley opponent off the mat. He is wrestling.
Tyler was able to keep his feet in bounds and finish the takedown. Let him go and got another takedown there off the whistle, and now we're getting some back points out of it.
Tyler's wrestling Gary Long of Tippecanoe Valley. Got a 3-point near fall count there, or a 5-count. And how you score near fall points is if you expose your opponent's shoulders to the mat at a 45-degree angle or more, the referee will start counting. And if he can get to a 2-count, you get a 2-point near fall. But if he can get all the way to a 5-count, you get your maximum of a near fall 3. And to score more, you actually have to break your hold to get more near fall points than what you did. So you could have an opponent.
And get to this right here. We want to be in a stand-up position, sitting in our chair. And that's where, you know, Tyler's just got to, he's got to sit in his chair a little bit better. Did a nice hip ice there and came out for one. Good front headlock, hitting the corner. Tyler did a nice job of moving there. Taking Gary's ankle and spinning by and getting his two. Now from here, yep, there we go. We're just getting behind. Good tight waist ride. It's breaking down.
We're up 8-0 at this point in the second period.
Looks like Tyler's locking in a chicken wing. Takes Gary over, and right now we're getting a count. Looks like we're going to get three out of this. Good shot at getting a fall, and there's the fall.
And he gets the fall. Rochester is now up 12-0 after two matches, going into 170 pounds. At 170, Rochester has...
wrestling Garrett Shane here today. Adam Basham tore his patella tendon. He was out for the season, so we had one of our JV wrestlers, Garrett Shane, step in, and he is wrestling 170 against Garrett Bell. Garrett right now is undefeated. Garrett Bell is undefeated. Sorry, we got two Garretts going here.
Garrett is a sophomore for Tippecanoe Valley. And I'm sorry, Garrett Bell,
yep,
is a sophomore.
Garrett and Shane's a junior.
Is a junior.
This is really his first true varsity action of the season. He wrestled a little bit up at South Bend Clay on our second team, but this is his first big test. So wrestling pretty well right now, holding good position, getting after it. The Bell kid from Valley's a tough, solid kid. Like I said, he's undefeated right now. One are John McKee, second in the conference last year as a freshman, actually behind Braxton Lee. So
he's got a lot of off-season wrestling experience under his belt already as a young sophomore.
Yep. Garrett's doing a nice job here. Good defense, Garrett Shane Rochester, getting his leg back, getting good pressure on Bell's shoulders. Doing a real nice job of making Bell work for it. Doing a good job there. Bell was able to, just too strong there, was able to pull the leg in, come around the corner. But Garrett Shane did a nice job for us fighting that off. Bell from Valley, he's on top right now. He's trying to run that chicken wing. Did a nice job of popping it out to his hip, and that's what you got to do. You got to get it out to your hip so you can run it. Garrett's, yep, coming around the corner here. That's exactly what you got to do. Limp arm out. Garrett Bell did a nice job of staying with that, getting his hips back over to the other side, and he's got us in trouble right here. And he picks up the fall.
With that, that closes the gap from 12-0 to 12-6 in favor of Rochester still going into
100. Oh, no, he didn't pick up the fall. We're wrong. Or I was wrong. Didn't pick up the fall yet. Time ran out. So we'll say Garrett did a nice job of fighting off his back. Good first move by Shane on bottom. He's just got to clear his arm. He didn't do a very good job of clearing his arm there. And Bell was able to trap a wrist on top, and now he's in pretty good shape here. We got to get our hips up on bottom, and we got to stay off our bellies and wrestle and just get stronger in this bottom position, keeping our heads up. Right now we're going Garrett Bell on top, going for a three-quarter Nelson. He's got the ankle trapped. Shane did a nice job of fighting it off, but Bell changed it right into a nice cradle. So we are in trouble. This is called a Cobra Cradle right here, where you've got the leg trapped. You got the head and the leg, and you're stepped over the leg, and there's the fall. There's not much. Once you get put in that, it's pretty tough to fight off your back there. So Shane did a nice job going into the second period with Garrett, but a lot of experience there. We kind of knew that was going to be a tough one going into that match.
That now has the score 12-6. Coming into 182
before the whistle, so we got a little caution there. Pretty good first move. Got caught with our hands down, and got to do a little bit better job of getting some back pressure. Keaton's got good pressure over the top, which is what you want. You want to have weight on our hands. Got a leg thrown in, looking for. He's got the arm right now, so he could be looking for a guillotine. He could look for a banana split if you take the leg. Right now, doesn't look like much is going to happen, but we certainly got to be moving on bottom. We're getting stuck here, wasting a lot of time.
We get a caution on Keaton.
Nice move by Keaton. We got caught pulling him backwards. That's just, you can't pull a good wrestler backwards like that and sit on your butt. And Keaton did a nice job of hip icing out of there and finishing the.
Keaton throws a leg in, trying to power half here to get a turn on Taylor.
I should expand on that. When Taylor pulled him backwards, Keaton was able to get a two reversal. That's where he started on bottom and was able to then come around and get behind Taylor, and that's called two reversal, and now we're in a lot of trouble here. Keaton threw legs in, power halved us to our back, and now we got the fall.
And gets the fall.
Right now we're, what, 12-12?
The score is now 12-12 after four matches, going into 195 pounds. Up at 195 pounds is Rochester's Wes Beck going against Tippecanoe Valley's Josh Back. Last year at this time, Wes was actually wrestling for Tippecanoe Valley, and for personal reasons, he came to Rochester and has been cleared by the IHSAA just a week earlier in the John McKee Memorial to be able to wrestle varsity competition, and quickly takes Josh to down and to his back. These two, I'm sure, have wrestled a lot in the Tippecanoe Valley practice room in the years past.
Yeah, and we kind of knew coming in that this is a pretty big mismatch right here. Wes is, you know, this young kid from Valley's a fighter and does a good job, but Wes is, I mean, gee, many Christmas, he's been wrestling since he probably was born, so he just got a lot of experience, and Wes is a tough athlete, and right now he's got a chicken wing locked up, kind of almost a double chicken wing, and we get the fall.
With that fall, it puts Rochester up 18-12 going into the 220-pound weight class.
Really, coming into this duel, we thought it was going to be a pretty close duel matchup. We were missing some key guys, and we thought this was going to be a little tougher duel. And it was. I mean, I shouldn't say it that way. It was a very tough duel, and Valley has some strong kids. But we were able to pick up some wins and do some nice things, and we were able to do pretty well here.
Next up is junior Jordan Schaefer for Rochester and junior Jaron Kidd for Tippecanoe Valley. These two wrestlers have met up quite a few times last year. They have not seen each other yet this year. However, both coming off impressive tournaments at the John McKee, with Jordan actually coming up with the championship at 220 pounds, and Jaron placed fourth out of the 16-team tournament.
Yeah, they wrestled three times last year. They wrestled here at the Super Duel. Jordan came out on top, and then they wrestled at the conference tournament in the finals last year, and Jordan came out on top again. So I think this is the third time now that they've met, and this was a pretty good battle just to begin with as well. Thank you. again, Jordan doing a nice job there of battling that underhook. I don't like him diving at the ankles like that. He got a little too aggressive, but luckily the out of bounds saved him a little bit there. But he's doing a nice job of pushing the pace.
As the wrestlers were on the edge of the mat there, Tippecanoe Valley got warned for stalling.
Again, underhook, he lifts it, doing a nice job of lifting it, and that's what you want to do. You want to get it as high as you possibly can in your armpit. We get a nice takedown right to his back, and I believe we're going to pick up the fall here. It's going to be tough to come out of. Jordan's got a nice cover there. He's chest on chest. There it is.
With that fall, Rochester now goes up 24-12 after the sixth match. There are 14 weight classes in a dual meet, so we are not quite yet halfway through this duel. Up next at heavyweight, we have Lane Coffing, who is wrestling Long of Tippecanoe Valley.
This was one of our bigger matchups in this dual meet. Lane is really a first-year wrestler. He wrestled in middle school, but hasn't wrestled since. So he's a junior. And the Long kid from Valley, I think he's a sophomore, but a pretty raw kid as well. So this was a huge matchup for the dual meet. Obviously, it's one we thought we could win, but you know, when you got two pretty raw kids here wrestling each other, and Lane's a very, very small heavyweight. He only weighs 215 pounds. So, you know, very raw both kids, but Lane does a nice job there fighting off a headlock. Did a nice job in this match and really wrestled hard for us. But this was one that was kind of a toss-up. We weren't real sure about this one. AJ Long. Do we know what grade AJ's in?
I believe he's a sophomore.
Sophomore. There again, AJ's trying for a headlock, and he got us this time. Lane did not a great job of fighting it off initially. Right there, he did a great job of coming out behind. But what we want to do there is we really want to be able to drop single. But Lane was able to come out on top, threw in a half, turning. We got the fall. That's a big, big win for Lane and for the Zebras.
That makes the score 30-12 going into the 106-pound weight class. That is, we are halfway through this duel with Rochester leading 30-12. Up at 106, we have Ben Garrick, who is wrestling Tippecanoe Valley's Albert Clevenger.
This was another big matchup for us, too. This was kind of one. Ben beat this kid at the John McKee in the first round, which was a big win for us there. Both these guys are very raw wrestlers. Ben is a first-year wrestler, cross-country kid that's come over to wrestling. And it's just a matter of teaching Ben some technique. He's got some great athletic ability. We just got to teach him how to be a wrestler and, kind of commit to that a little bit as well as some of the other things that he does. But I have a lot of high hopes for Ben. He's obviously a small kid, so he's a kid who could be a 106-pounder for us for a couple years and really help us out. Great build, great little athlete. Just got to teach him some wrestling. And you can see both these guys are pretty raw, but Ben's doing a nice job of staying under his arms and throwing half Nelsons and putting this kid to his back, and we're going to get another set of back points here. And Ben did a nice job for us. This was a big matchup, and Ben gets the fall.
With that fall, Rochester is now up 36-12.
A lot longer than 5 minutes, but in reality it is, because you have to get the blood stop first, and then there's cleanup time. Right now, Coach Holloway and myself are giving Cole some advice on just how to finish his chicken wing, how to tighten it up. Just talking to him about some things that he can do a little bit better there. I'm very appreciative of the fact that we're wearing black. Black is very slimming. I need all the help that I can get most times. We chose to bring him back neutral. We feel like we can take him down about any time we want. So we brought Valley back neutral. As the top man, we have that choice. If we want to go ahead and give him a point and bring him up and not waste time, then that gives us the chance to do that. Right there, Cole got a little sloppy, reaching for the head, kind of charging in, not protecting his legs. Doing a nice job of fighting it off, but not a position we want to be in, that's for sure.
He's out, so he has to kind of go back to getting control. Doesn't want to get too high and get reversed and turned to his back. Cole's got a nice half in here. He's got him.
Got a wrist and a half, and he's really driving that hard. That hurts.
Again, as Coach was mentioning, you know, when you got a wrist in and you're trying to turn a half Nelson, it really puts a lot of pressure on the abdomen area of your opponent, causing him not to be able to breathe as well, especially in a time when you're already tired during a match. So it's a very effective move in wearing your opponent down. He now has him exposed and gets a fall. With
nice
that victory. Sorry, Coach.
No, he just nice job by Cole, just staying with it, being patient, just driving the kid, putting a lot of pressure on him. Just did a nice job there. You know, just sticking with it, just getting after it and sticking with it.
And with that fall, that puts Rochester up 42-12 with five matches to go. At this point, without any team penalty points taken away, if Tippecanoe Valley were to get a fall at every weight class on the way out, the best they can do is tie Rochester at this point. Right now we have Aaron Orr, a sophomore for Rochester, going up against Austin Nault of Tippecanoe Valley. They have wrestled last week, as a matter of fact, the week prior to this match, Austin becoming the victor by 7-3 decision at the, for fifth place at the John McKee Memorial.
Yeah, this was another big, big matchup for us. We really, you know, just based on the John McKee results, we weren't sure what we were going to get. Aaron did a nice job of getting in on a leg there, but, you know, again, stayed on his knees, and the kid was able to neck wrench him almost to his back and then come out for two. So that's something we've worked hard on in the last couple weeks of just Aaron not finishing on his knees. You always want to drive up. You always want to be on your feet, finishing up and in so things like that can't happen.
Right now, Aaron is in the defensive position down 2-0 early in the match. These head-to-head matches are very, very critical in the seeding process for the conference tournament. So today actually is a big day for Rochester wrestling. Three, possibly more, conference opponents going into the seeding meeting Monday.
A third time with a chicken wing. So, but I also understand why they do. You know, you get 1 point, you come out on top, or come out of there, and you know, you close the game, now it's 6-4 match instead of 6-3, and the takedown gets right in there. So
Aaron's doing a nice job. He ran his chicken wing, scored near fall points. He broke that offensive move and now has a cradle locked up to hope to get a different set of near fall points. And this goes back to what we were explaining earlier in the duel. Aaron turned Nault twice with the exact same move but did not break his hold, so he only got one set of near fall points for that turn, even though he turned him twice. But now he's getting a different set of count, so he will have a second set of near fall points in this match because of a different offensive hold or maneuver.
Well, and sometimes I'll try to expand on that a little bit. Some officials, more experienced officials, I'll say, will, if you run a chicken wing and you get back points out of it and you come back up on top, even if you have the same hold, but the wrestler fights to his base and stays on his base for a certain amount of time, they'll go ahead and award the near fall points, and then you'll have another opportunity to come back and run the same hold again. In reality, that's not necessarily the right way to do it. You know, the rule book is pretty clear that it needs to be a change of hold, but it really does become a change of hold if the wrestler is able to hold his base and not go to his back for a second time pretty quickly. So John Hunting here is getting a forfeit. Valley did not have a 126-pounder, so John will receive a forfeit. Now Justin Schroeder's coming out to wrestle one of Tippecanoe Valley's better wrestlers, Devin Childers.
As these two wrestlers are getting prepared to start wrestling, going back to Aaron Orr's match, that last near fall that he got there at the end of the third period gave him an 11-3 victory, getting a major decision and scoring 14 points for the team. That secured the duel for Rochester at this point on this tournament, but we still have a few big matches going, and Rochester is trying to increase the lead as Valley is obviously trying to catch up. So we've already guaranteed the tournament victory, barring any type of illegal holds or moves or team points getting deducted from the team.
Devin does a nice job of coming out really, really fast. You watch a lot of his matches, he comes out quick, scores points early. And here he got in on a single, came out the back door like you've seen some of our kids do. Right into a cradle on Justin. Devin's a strong kid. He's got a cradle locked up, and this is going to end badly for us. But Justin, having said that, I'm not sure Justin was really ready for this match, and ready for the pace that Devin comes out at. One thing I've noticed with Devin, if you can withstand that first barrage of points, and you can stay with him for a little bit, you can slow him down and wrestle with him. But, he just came out so fast on us, hit a nice takedown right into a cradle and was able to finish it. So,
with two matches to go going in here to the 138-pound weight class, Rochester is now up 52-18. And on the map for Rochester is Otto Serbundi, his first varsity experience for the season, stepping in for Jay Heckathorn here at 138 pounds, going up against Tippecanoe Valley's Wyatt Nelson, a junior for Tippecanoe Valley. Another very experienced wrestler. His father is an assistant coach. You can actually see the top of his head right there on the screen right now.
He's balding a little bit. He's the guy who's got less hair than I do. It's always nice to be able to commentate on these and kind of take shots at other people. It's kind of fun.
Otto's in on a single leg.
Otto really did a nice job of getting in on a single leg there. He just didn't run his feet. Had a single leg, had it right where he wanted to be, and he just took it the wrong way. He tried to dump it, which is what Nelson was forcing him to do. And, instead of dumping it, he just needed to run it. And if he'd have ran it, probably would have finished the takedown. But, Otto did a nice job. He had to step in for us at 138. Our normal 38-pounder was out that day, Otto did a very, very nice job for us. And I know he gave up the fall there and was disappointed, but, I don't have a whole lot of bad things to say about Otto Serbundi. He's a tough, hardworking kid.
And our final match of the day is Ben Horbin versus Valley's Cody Runyon. They have not seen each other yet this year. However, they have wrestled in the past, and I believe Cody's come out on top each and every time.
Yep.
This is another big match for seeding for Rochester in the conference, as well as Valley for the conference. These are your 1 and 2 wrestlers in the entire conference. And, it's always better to get the number one seed because you were only going to wrestle the fourth seed instead of the third seed who's, by records head-to-head is the better wrestler. So it's a little bit easier path to get to the finals. So this is a big match for both wrestlers here today. But Cody gets the first takedown. That's kind of one of Ben's Achilles' heels, is he is not very good at getting that first takedown in his matches. If he could figure that out and actually be able to get more first takedowns on kids, he could be in a lot better position in a lot of his matches against better quality opponents. These two wrestlers have the opportunity, like we mentioned a little while ago, to see each other 2-3 more times yet this season. They both are hoping to, advance far in the state tournament as it starts 2 weeks from this date. So, they're both trying to get some good experience and improve heading into the state series.
you can tell Ben kind of gets stretched out when he's on bottom. You know, he doesn't do a very good job of keeping his elbows close to his knees, and what I mean by that is kind of wrestling up in a ball. He gets stretched out too easy, which, you know, then he gives up his arms, or the running kid's able to get legs in, and then you make it very tough to get off bottom in this position. Ben does a nice job of getting his hips up and trying to keep his knees together, but again, you can see where his elbows are. You know, when your hips come up, then your elbows have to come back, or your knees have to come up to your elbows. Every time we come up to our base, Cody does a very nice job of getting a leg in, and we're not wrestling tight enough on bottom. What I mean by that is elbows back to our knees and wrestling in the back. So, excuse me, it just makes it very, very tough. Ben. You know, a lot of time burning on the clock, and he's taking our energy, and Cody's doing a very nice job here.
At the conclusion of this match, Rochester will be wrestling Northfield, and Tippecanoe Valley will be wrestling Southwood, and then we will flip-flop and wrestle the other schools as well in our pool. We will move forward in the progress of this day and go into the Clinton Central duel, where Rochester and Tippecanoe Valley were able to beat both Northfield and Southwood, respectively, in their duels. So Rochester placed first in their pool. Tippecanoe Valley will have placed second in their pool. So we both will be wrestling the first and second places of the Pool B, which ended up being West Central and Clinton Central both. Both Clinton Central and West Central represented in the second annual IHSAA.
IHSWCA.
Thank you. Sorry about that. The Coaches Association State Tournament that they have some calculations and formulas that they work on to get their top eight schools, and they both were able to participate in that. Due to time constraints, we move into the 126-pound weight class against Clinton Central, and we have John Hunting versus Archibald of Clinton Central. Currently, right now, Zebras have a 21-18 team point lead against the Clinton Central with this match and three more matches to go. So really, we're halfway through the duel, and it's a very close duel meet at this point.
The kid from Clinton Central is a pretty solid kid. He's a big, strong kid. I believe he's a senior, possibly a junior. Very, very one of their more solid kids. So this was a big swing match for us. John's doing a nice job of being patient. Hits a real nice low single for a finish. Doesn't get two yet. Oh, he gave two. Probably shouldn't have, honestly, because there hadn't been pressure on his head yet, or on his hands. But he did a nice job of getting two there and staying with him. Archibald's trying to switch on bottom to come out for his own two-point reversal, and John did a nice job of staying up behind the arms and staying with him there.
Again, Clinton Central represented the single A class of the Coaches Association State Tournament the week prior, placing seventh in the single A division. There are three divisions that they have incorporated into the Coaches Association. Rochester is in the 2A division. However,
we're getting ready to see a big move here by John Hunting. Hits a spladle, sets the kid up perfectly for it. Hits a real nice spladle and gets the fall for us. That was a pretty exciting move. Our whole team bench, coaching staff, everybody was pretty darn excited for John and hitting that. That was a nice job by John to come out of that, and a big, big swing match for us.
Big swing match. It pumped up the team. You can kind of see the kids up in the corner of the screen moving around a little bit. We got a forfeit right after this match. However, it gave the momentum that the rest of the wrestlers needed to get pumped up and to secure this victory. Rochester goes on and wins this duel 51-30 to secure the victory going against West Central here. For the final duel of the day for the title. Okay, here we go against our West Central Trojans, the fifth match of the day. Both teams are undefeated, have easily defeated all their opponents for the day. So this is the true championship match for Super Duels. Up first is at 195 is Westbeck, is going against the West Central opponent. Had him lifted up there. Had a lot of weight to lift up right there to not come away with a two takedown. West Central was the third place recipient for the Coaches Association in the Single A Coaches Association tournament. And we want to see how we stack up against the Single A teams as well as the 2A. If you remember back on our first duel of the year was against New Prairie. That was televised on Channel 4. Rochester was wrestling New Prairie and lost by 6 points. And New Prairie also represented in the 2A division of the Coaches Association, placing third in that division as well. Rochester did not have West Beck in our lineup at that time. And had we had him in there, that would have been at least a 9-point swing in Rochester's favor. Giving us the victory against the team that plays 3A in the same division that we are in. Rochester was not invited to participate in the 18 dual tournament this season. Even if we were, we may not have been able to participate as it was on the exact same weekend as our John McKean Memorial Tournament.
Right, this year's state qualifying teams are based off of last year's results, and those results are all scored by how you do at your sectional, regional, semi-state, and state. Last year we were in pretty good position to get an invite, but we did not, by probably about 30 points. We needed to score around 30 more points to get an invitation to the tournament itself. As you can see right there, West Beck scored a 2-point takedown there just right at the buzzer. And now he's going down. Score should be 2-0 right now for Rochester. And it looks like he's going to get one here pretty quick. And it'll be 3-0. But we didn't get the invite. We needed to have two more guys either move on from our sectional to our regional or from our regional to our semi-state. Or we needed to really have probably at least one state qualifier. So we just didn't score enough points, and we didn't get the invite. But as you said, we wrestled New Prairie to a 36-30 loss, and they placed third at Team State this year, losing to Yorktown, who is probably one of the top 5 or 10 teams in the state of Indiana. Very, very, very solid wrestling program, and New Prairie lost a very lopsided duel to Yorktown, but then New Prairie dominated every other team that they wrestled down there to place third. So, you know, I guess I feel like as a coach that tells us we're sitting in a pretty good position, and we probably could have done pretty well down there, probably been a top four team. So wrestling West Central and Clinton Central on this day, Clinton Central was the seventh best team in the state, and West Central was the third best team at 1A. And obviously we beat Clinton Central in the duel before that, and we end up winning the West Central duel as well. So, you know, I feel like we have a team that can stack up. Right now we're sitting in pretty good position to be able to qualify for Team State this year. We still got a couple more weekends of wrestling to go, but if we wrestle solid like we have been, we have a shot at being one of the top 12 teams next year. And hopefully they don't host it on the John McKee weekend and we'll be able to accept the invitation and go down. So hopefully that'll work out for our program.
Yeah, as Clint just alluded to, the top 12, it has expanded from 8 teams to 12 for next year, giving Rochester an even better chance of getting that invite. We do have 4 seniors on our roster this year. Going to be very tough to replace those young men. However, we do have a good group of juniors and a few sophomores on this squad that are doing a great job. I believe Ben Garrick is our single freshman mm-hmm. on the varsity squad right yep. now. So, you know, we're looking for good things next year. Those seniors will be hard to replace, but, you know, we'll move on and then hopefully be able to have another great season. As of right now, dual meet record-wise, the Zebras are 17-2, and after Coach just mentioned, after they win this duel, they'll be 18-2. By the time that we have got to do our commentating on this recorded match, we had wrestled Pioneer during the week and defeated them 77-0. Not something that you can do on any team very often. A perfect victory is 84-0. That's all falls or forfeits all the way through. So we had a major decision and a decision on one of the matches. So we scored 77, did not get beat once. So that was a good finish to the season, finishing 19-2 on this season. Puts us number two overall in percentage of victory to losses in the history of Rochester wrestling. So, very good team. A lot of fun we've been having this year, and still got a few more weeks to go. So we want to continue the success and get to some of our goals that we have set.
West doing a very good job of riding this young man. He's up 3-0 right now, and riding very, very solid.
As the wrestlers make their way back to the center, there's a lot of action. You see guys tend to hang out on the bottom here in the middle of the mat, but once they get close to the edge, they tend to take a few more chances, knowing that, you know, I can get out of bounds to not give up any extra points. Now, one thing, Wes just got a nice two-point reversal right there, right on the edge of the mat. You can see that his legs and toes are in. The other wrestler is totally out of bounds, so he does not get any near-fall points when his shoulders are outside of the gold circle into the out-of-bounds area. However, if your toes and knees are inside of, in this case, the gold, you're going to get awarded the points for the reversal or takedown or whatever the case may be.
That was the end of the match there. The young man actually with that reversal had tied the match up 3-3. And then Wes had come right back and got another reversal and won 5-3. So there was some good action there at the end of that match. Two very solid wrestlers, solid kids. And now we have Jordan Schaefer wrestling another very good 220-pounder from West Central. So this is also a very good match. And a crucial match for the dual meet.
Very crucial. The top three wrestlers here, as in weight-wise, the 195, 220, and heavyweight for West Central, are very good wrestlers for their squad. So, again, Wes was a big match. This is a big match. And then the heavyweight will also be a match that we would like to learn and maybe get some good experience off of, and if not, pull out a victory.
Both guys are trying to feel each other out right now, and just kind of Jordan's starting off a little slower than what I'd like for him to do. He's just kind of wrestling a little timid right now, and like to see him get after it a little bit more. West Central kid's doing a lot of pushing to the face. Now you can see they're locking up here pretty hard and maybe throwing some headbutts in there, so I think tempers are starting to flare.
You can see the referee throws up both fists in the air, which indicates stalling on both men. Even though they're pushing and shoving is what I would call it here, they're not really doing a lot to actually take each other down. Although you just saw Jordan just miss a takedown by his toe just going out of bounds.
His toe went out of bounds first, and then he brought it back in, and that doesn't count. Yeah, it has to be in bounds to start with.
Again, right. Coach, go ahead.
Right there, we got a one-point penalty call. The young man from West Central is doing a lot of pushing and shoving and to our face, and his thumb went into our eye. And now you can see the official looking at Jordan's eye. Jordan's got a pretty good knot over his eye, and it's starting to swell shut. He's having trouble seeing right now. So we'll take a little bit of time and get him squared away, and then we'll come back to the center and we'll get going again.
Again, like Coach said, the West Central's first move off the bottom is not real tough to defend.
No, not at all. He's given up his wrist, and he's got, you can see all the weights on his hands, and Jordan, you know, you just take that wrist, and collapse the elbow down, and it's pretty easy to, especially with these bigger guys, you get them over that wrist or over a collapsed elbow, it's harder than heck for them to get up.
Jordan tried to lock up a cradle there, another cross face, which is a far side cradle. You don't see very many big wrestlers locking up cradles. But these are two very athletic kids, as we've mentioned before, and they're going to try. Rochester attempts to do another crossface to a bundle. West Central wrestler gets a little bit frustrated and throws an elbow, and the referee calls him for another penalty point, putting Rochester up 3-0 with short time left in this third and final period. Another fairly easy breakdown for Jordan. Hits another crossface. Wrestler gives him a little jab with the back of his head there.
Yeah, he does it again here in just a second.
He's a little frustrated.
Yeah.
And there's another little. His head needs to be up at all times anyway, but he's kind of leaving it down, maybe for that little intentional, unintentional headbutt. But good match, good intense match by both wrestlers.
Absolutely.
Puts both wrestlers. Rochester wins the first two duels by decision, puts them up 6-0. Going into the heavyweight match.
We got Lane Coffin wrestling, probably West Central's best wrestler. Their heavyweight's very, very solid kid.
Lazarus Conley.
He's ranked very high in our semi-state right now. He got a two-point takedown, two-point near fall going out of bounds. So Lane's on bottom. Got a tough task here. Got a very, very young wrestler against a big, strong, experienced heavyweight. So, Lane's wrestling tough, though. Wrestling hard, wrestling tough, coming off bottom.
Again, Lane's getting to his feet, but he just can't quite put the opponent's hand in his back pocket and get his hips away so he can spin and get his one escape.
Right. Part of that is, you know, kid's a big, strong kid, so he gets his hands locked around you and you're going to have a hard time breaking them. But now he's got them split. He's got to put him in his back pocket.
There he gets
it. Got a penalty point. Lane was only, you could see it there, Lane was only grabbing one finger. You have to grab all four fingers to be able to get away. If you only grab one, it's illegal. So, not a very good, while it'll work, it's not a very good way to escape, especially if the official sees it.
Back to his feet again.
Yeah, he's got the hand split. He just cannot get one hand. And the thing he's doing wrong there is he's really got to focus on one hand instead of both hands. If he gets two of his hands on one of his opponent's hands, then he can put it in his back pocket and turn. But he's grabbing both, and it's just hard to do that. Excuse me.
Well, since we've got a power half, got us on our shoulder, now we're in trouble.
Yeah, it's going to be a hard time.
And there's your fall. So, after the 285-pound weight class in the third match of this duel, the score is all knotted up, 6-6. We go from the big boys to the little boys at 106. Ben Garrick is wrestling his West Central opponent. Gotta make sure the big guys get off the mat before these little guys get after it.
And again, probably two pretty inexperienced kids here. Ben You know, Ben's been wrestling since November. I think this kid is either a sophomore or a junior, so he's got a little bit more experience than Ben does. But Ben wrestles hard, gets after him here a little bit. Turn your back to your opponent, that's for sure.
Yeah, he's got the legs put on tight. This is a tough hold to get out of if anybody can. Yeah. So he gets the quick fall and puts West Central up 6-12. I should say 12-6.
You got your head and arm trapped, and then both legs are hooked, and you don't have any way to bridge or get an arm through. It's very, very tough to come out of that. Excuse me.
Pulled out and coming up at 113 here against West Central. Last name of Young. Young's in on a shot. Cole just defends it nicely. Hips into it and actually gets his takedown. He's got a cradle locked up.
Yep. Nice cradle. Yep, we got the fall there.
Quick fall. 15-second fall for Cole here on the day.
Did a nice job with his hips.
And ties the score up, ties the team score up 12-12. Now we've got Aaron Orr. Here at 120. He's actually wrestling a young lady by the name of Michaela Bushman. He's in on the takedown. He's got a far side arm bar and a near side chicken wing. He's out to the side ready to run it. Gets her extended back out.
Yeah, she's, did you say she's a senior?
I don't know what her grade is.
She's been, this is her third year at least, so she's been on their team now for the last couple of years, so.
And we get a quick fall by Aaron. Puts the Zebras back up 18-12. Going into the seventh match of this duel, and we have John Hunting now up for at 126 pounds. John was the match that we did for the Clinton Central where he splatled the kid and ignited the team in a close duel and ended up walking away with it by 21 points against Clinton Central the duel before.
Nice little outside single there by John. John started wrestling in the sixth grade and has just improved tremendously, put in a lot of hard work. Pretty good little athlete, fearless wrestler. Likes to wrestle quite a bit. And likes to try different things and experiment. We saw that in the Clinton Central duel where he, hit that splatel. Score was tied 2-2, and he came out of there. And big match for us in that duel. And then obviously coming out here and just getting after this kid. And you can see him doing some different things that you don't see the other kids do. And right now we're working just for a stack. And he's just doing a nice job. John's really had a great season for us so far. And going to pick up the fall here in a minute.
Well, John is quietly leading many categories, statistical categories for the Zebras this year. And he gets the fall here.
Puts us up 24-12 now, I believe.
It does. It's interesting that you say John likes to try new things because I was thinking the same thing when he hit that splatel. I've never seen him try that in his 3 years at the high school level and certainly not at the middle school level.
Right.
So after halfway through the duel, the Zebras are up 24-12. Now we have Justin Schroeder, 132 pounds, wrestling another decent wrestler for West Central, Micklewain. I remember this name for at least 3 years as well.
Yeah.
So if he's not a senior, he's got to be at least a junior.
Doing a lot of a lot of hopping up and down there, and I think that's going to cost him here in a little bit. You can't. That's not good motion on his part as far as the West Central kid goes.
Interesting tidbit about Justin. Justin was our 113-pound varsity wrestler last year, so he's bumped up 19 pounds in weight to wrestle at this weight class, and actually was a bigger kid than that at the very beginning of the season coming off of tennis.
Yeah, he's grown quite a bit. There's not a very good stance there. He needs to do a better job of holding his position, and did a nice job of fighting that off. Nice crossface, good whizzer. So you can see how Justin's legs, sometimes they get a little close. See how his feet come close together there? That's not good position there. That's why guys get in on his legs a little too easy. He needs to keep a better staggered stance and keep his feet a little further apart so he can move. Does a nice job of sitting in the corner. Kid took a low ankle with the head to the outside. Not a very good shot on his part. That's just not, you want your head on the inside when you take a low single like that, because you allow your opponent to sit the corner, which is what we did here. Now we got a leg thrown in, we got an ankle hooked, and I think we had a 2-point takedown and then a 2-point reversal for the kid from West Central. So
scores 2-2.
Yep.
And Justin showed a good example there. Even if a guy's in on a shot, whether it's good or not, he knocked us to our hip or on our butt, and we did not sit there. He got right off of his hip, and high hip usually wins in those scramble-type positions right there. Okay, end of first period. West Central defers.
Right, fill in when they need to fill in, and they give great workout partners every single day. So it does make a difference, but... Our boys fight hard and get after it, and that's all that matters. Right now, Justin's doing a very good job of, he was able to take this young man down, and now he's just riding legs, being real tough on him, really turned the tide on this kid, and he's having a hard time getting off bottom and doing much. You can tell he's getting a little tired, got an illegal hold on Justin. Justin kind of dug his elbow there to the back of his head, and that's just not something you can do. Those are the little things, you know, you can't do those things in tight matches. Justin's in control right now, but if this match was a 0-0 or 1-1, you know, and you give a kid a point, those are just the little things you can't do. So, but Justin's aggressive and he gets after it, and I'd rather him be aggressive and go for stuff than, you know, be timid. And those are just some things he's got to learn.
Central gets in on a quick switch on Justin, and he wasn't able to adjust from it. Rochester now, Justin gets an escape. We are short on time, and actually right now at this point in the match, Rochester is down 6-7. We need a takedown to win this match, or at least take the lead. I'm sorry, I was wrong. We were winning by 1-6 already.
Yep.
We got that escape to put us up. We were tied when he got the reversal. We got the escape to put us up by 1 with short time left. The West Central kid was the one that was the aggressor trying to get the takedown. So we won 8-7 that match. Puts us up 27-12 via the team score.
Justin did a nice job there picking up that escape right after that reversal. It's just a good example of just not giving up and not quitting and not getting your head down and not being down on yourself and finishing the match hard. And now we got Otto Scherbondi, who's filling in at 138 for us, or 140, I guess I should say, and did a nice job. This kid right here that he's wrestling is a tough, tough kid, and we took him down. And Otto's really doing a nice job. Really filled in nice. Just real proud of this kid.
Sorry,
you guys that don't know the story on Otto, Otto, as a 8th grader, weighed about 220 pounds, and right now he's wrestling at 140 pounds. So, and he's just a workaholic. Runs all the time, lifts all the time, always calling me or texting me and asking me for different workouts that he can do, and just never misses workouts when the wrestling room's open or the weight room's open. And just very proud of how far Otto has come, and he did a nice job today filling in for us, or on this day filling in for us. And won a couple key matchups for us, and didn't get pinned in some matches that were also big. So just a good kid. Glad to have him in the program.
Another good example. My daughter's a statistician for the high school team, and she mentioned that Otto ran a mile after practice in 5 minutes and 30 seconds yesterday. Which I guess last year he did this. You know, he was pushing himself for a time to see what he could do. I don't know that we have very many varsity team members that can run a 5-minute 30-mile.
Well, he was running with the varsity yesterday. It was actually before practice.
Okay.
It was before practice, but he was running with the regional qualifiers yesterday, and he ran a 5:33. The next closest person was a 6:03.
Okay.
So.
Anyway, still an impressive feat for this young man.
Yeah, and considering at the beginning of the year his best was a 6:15, so he dropped he dropped almost 45 seconds off his mile. He just works hard, and you know you'll see during this match right here. Even though he ended up, you know, with a 2 reversal here and the score is tied 2-2 right now, you will see him really push this kid and get this kid fatigued. And
this young man, Denton is his last name, actually ends up winning this weight class today. On this day, he destroyed the first 4 opponents that he wrestled. And Otto just kept pushing the pace, and did a real nice job of during this match.
Start off the whistle. Otto's got to be a little more aggressive off the whistle there. That kid did a nice job of kind of hip heisting and scooting around the corner and comes out for 1. Again, Otto's right back in on the legs. We got to finish that better, that's for sure. Otto let his hips get too low, and the kid was able to kind of hip him over, but no point scored. So those are the things that wear your opponent out. Just keep wrestling.
Otto's in on another single.
Mm-hmm.
Switches off to the double. Yeah, he's got the kid on his hips. He's climbing up.
Yep, you can see Otto's right hand coming up the back. When he does that, that becomes a 2-point takedown. Now we're ahead 4-3 right now. 4-3. Otto had in a nice chicken wing, but didn't run it in the right direction. Young man was able to come out of it. Denton on bottom's doing a nice job of staying kind of in a ball and moving, and he ends up coming out of there for, I believe the official gave him a 1-point escape, and now he's going to give him a 2-point takedown. Nope, just a reversal there, no escape.
So he is now up 5-4.
Mm-hmm. And right here, Otto's got to get his hips up. That was a nice job. There again, you can see, though, how his elbows were so far away from his ribs that Denton was able to put legs in, and now probably not looking to turn us as much as he's looking to just try to get a right out. He is getting some back points there, did a nice job with what they call some people call it a Superman, but just lifting, using his legs to lift the hip and then rotate. Did a nice job there.
I believe he got a 3-point near fall for that as well, so that put him up
8-4, I believe.
8-4 going into the third period. He chose to go down.
Again, you get to that tripod position where your elbows are away from your knees, those legs can come in. You get a tall kid like Denton with some experience, he's riding legs, and you know, probably not going to get too many turns here, but he's definitely wasting a lot of time, and Otto's going to have trouble coming out of this. So this is where Otto's got to get that leg out of there and get his elbows to his knees and start working to come up in a good standing position. Denton on top there, I believe, beat Nelson earlier in the day.
Go the other way. Hard.
I'm not sure what the score was, but you saw in our Valley match, Otto lost by fall to the Nelson kid. And this kid from West Central beat Otto, or beat Nelson as well. So Nelson last year was a semi-state qualifier, is that correct?
Yes, he was.
Otto's bringing his hips up, but he's just not, he's not bringing them up to his elbows. And that's, it just doesn't do you much good there. Now we're in good position. Now we're in a position where we can get some back pressure, see how he spreads out there, and gives him a good position to get some back pressure and come up. This is good to sit here and commentate and watch this, because now we've got some more things I can work on in practice.
That's right. Is getting near full count now. And there's your final, a decision for the West Central wrestler over Otto, putting the team score, Rochester 27, West Central 15.
And that's a big match in the dual meet because Otto was able to hold him to a decision.
That's right, not giving up the bonus points, what we like to call them.
Right, so, you know, Otto loses by, you know, he lost, I believe it was 10-3, so he loses a 7-point decision. And he only gives up 3 team points. So even though Otto loses, you know, that's still a big victory for the team because we're not giving up extra bonus points. And in a tight dual meet like this, that's pretty darn important. So, again, here we've got Ben Horbin wrestling, one of West Central's better kids. This 45-pounder, probably their second-best kid on the team. And, you know, you can see he's kind of wrestling real tough right now and muscling Ben around. Ben's just got to get more aggressive. Ben's one of our hardest working kids and knows a lot of good wrestling, but he's just not very aggressive and something we've been working on. Had a big win at the TRCs this last week against the Runyon kid who beat him today and on this tape. And you know, Ben obviously can do it. It's just a matter of kind of bringing that out in him and getting him ready and getting him aggressive.
An interesting statistical thing on Ben. Ben is he's a very good wrestler on top, and he has more than double near fall points than the second most person on the team. So he's very good at tilting and getting those near fall points, but his Achilles heel tends to be his neutral wrestling or wrestling on his feet.
And again, I think that comes from just the aggressive attitude. It's not that Ben doesn't know good wrestling on his feet. It's just that he's just not very aggressive. You know, and I think the more when we see Ben get very aggressive and get after his opponents, then we see him really taking guys down and doing a good job. But he's, you know, he sometimes lets the other guy dictate, and that's just not a good.
Nothing good will come of it. Ben is one of our 4 seniors on the team that I remember coaching Ben in the elementary level. I remember seeing him coming in and saying, this kid's got a future.
Mm-hmm.
And even back then, Ben needed to be aggressive. Ben, you got to get aggressive. And he's just a real quiet, reserved young man. And he goes after it. He works hard. And that mentality is a little bit different. It's fun to see these young men coming in third, fourth, and fifth grade, or even younger, in today's standards, and watching them grow up and become seniors, and it's going to be fun to see what these guys do when they get older.
Well, and all those kids, if you look at Tyler and you look at Ben and Braxton, they've all been wrestling at least since middle school. I know Braxton or Ben and Tyler have been wrestling in our elementary program for a long time. You know, Braxton was a move-in from Caston, started wrestling in the middle school level. You look at Josh Heckathorn, he's been wrestling, you know, Wes Beck, both those guys been wrestling since elementary school, and you can just tell. I mean, those kids, you can tell the kids that have put in that time, and that's what it takes. I mean, you've got to be willing to put in that time and start at an earlier age, and you can see that. I know Ben's losing this match right now, but you know, to think of how far Ben's come and some of these other guys when they were younger and the amount of time that they put in, they've done a real nice job and had great seasons. And you know, I think today Ben ended up 3-2 on this day. Lost to two pretty tough kids, and one of those losses we get to avenge here at the conference tournament. So, you know, these guys are going to be very productive young men when they get out of high school, go to college, get jobs, have families. These are three kids that I don't worry about.
Well, and you got to add in Taylor Pugh onto this as well. He is a first-year wrestler, but this young man has done a great job filling in at a weight where, you know, really he's a first-year wrestler.
Yep.
Interesting part about Taylor was his father was on the wrestling team when I was back in high school. So he doesn't come from a line of no wrestling background whatsoever. I'm sure he and his father have talked a little bit about it and probably do. Even, you know, maybe they go home and critique matches and stuff like that after it's over. Up next is another senior, Braxton Lee, who we've talked a little bit about. Here at
152.
Thank you.
He's up 2-0 right now.
And the team score 27-15. Going into here to 152, and the next three out of four matches are seniors for us. So really, we finished today. The last four or five matches were our seniors. So it was kind of neat to see that quartet of seniors getting to finish off this championship day.
Braxton's got legs in, and he's got a cross face, and now he's got what we call body scissors. And you can tell he's squeezing the body scissors. You can't use it to punish, but if you're pinning a young man, you can certainly use it to help you pin him. So there's kind of a fine line there, and you got to be careful with it. But yeah, talking about Taylor Pugh, Taylor has done a nice job at 182 of filling in. I think he's got 15 or 16 wins this season. Ended up being a regional qualifier as a first-year wrestler. You know, and he's done a nice job. And Taylor's one of those guys. He came to me earlier in the season or early in the year, and he wanted to wrestle last year and had to get a job. And he felt like he wanted to do something productive, and he wanted to do something to end his senior year with something positive. And you know, so he wanted to wrestle. And you know, Taylor, I think wrestling will serve him and do him well as you know too. And hopefully, he's learned many lessons that he'll need. And I think he'll be fine.
Now, beyond high school, Coach, isn't Braxton and Tyler both going to play football in college?
I don't think Braxton is. I think Braxton is going to – well, Braxton and Tyler are both going to University of Indianapolis. I think Braxton's going to try to walk on and wrestle, and Tyler's going to walk on and play football.
Okay.
And I think Keaton Bell is going to try to walk on and wrestle as well. So it's kind of nice to have some of these guys move on, and I think – Ben Horbin might even be going to he's either going to be going to University of Indianapolis or maybe IUPUI. I don't think he's decided yet, but I know Braxton and Tyler both decided on U of I, and Keaton has decided on University of Indianapolis as well. And so they've got good programs down there as far as what those boys want to do. I think Braxton's going to go into education and have a minor maybe in business. I think Tyler's going to go into pre-med. So, you know, they both have lofty goals. I know Ben wants to go into engineering, I think mechanical engineering.
That is not easy to do.
No, and all three of those boys can do it. They all three get great grades. They do a nice job in school, and I think they'll do great in college. I think, you know, the careers that they've chosen or that they've got right now that they want to do, I think they'll be great at them. I think Taylor Pugh is going to go into the Marines, either the Army or Marines. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think that's a great choice for Taylor. I think that he'll flourish in something like that. He's a kid who needs that discipline and that, you know, somebody pushing him. And I think that's one of the big reasons why he wanted to wrestle this year, is because he wanted to prepare himself for that as well. And you know, you're not going to, if you're a guy that's going to go into the any kind of armed forces whatsoever, you are not going to find anything better to prepare you than wrestling.
That's exactly right.
You know, there's the Navy SEALs every year go up to Minnesota, University of Minnesota, when they duel big teams like Iowa and Penn State, and they have a Navy SEAL recruiter go and not only talk to the high school wrestlers that show up in attendance, but they also go and they talk to the college wrestlers because they want to recruit collegiate wrestlers, guys that have gone through collegiate wrestling, to be a Navy SEAL because they have so many of the same skill sets that Navy SEALs have. And, you know, so that's kind of an interesting thing. I wish more kids would wrestle, that's for sure.
As we got into a little bit more here, you see that Braxton was riding very tough, doing a lot of torquing on the West Central opponent, and ended up getting a quick fall or a fall there in the second period. And that puts the team score 33-15 with just three matches to go. Again, that actually puts this into a guaranteed tie for this duel with these three matches. But we've still got Tyler Downauer here going as another senior for us. And which we, you know, talked a little bit about him during that match as well. But yeah, Tyler come out with what I like to call his guns blazing here. He was ready to wrestle this match, and is really taking it to this West Central wrestler early in this match already. Yes, this Rochester squad, I mentioned earlier that after this duel and then the Pioneer match that we had talked about earlier, finishing 19-2 on this season and second overall all-time in winning percentage for a season, there are three other team statistical stats that we track of, and they're going to be in all four of them with this team. How high they finish will be up to them and what they decide to do the rest of the season here.
Tyler there didn't get it. He did a nice job of trying to jump his hips back over to finish that chicken wing, but he didn't have his arm free. So the kid was able to continue to roll through. And, you know, he came out for one. I think Tyler got a couple back points there, but the kid was able to roll through and come out for one. But right now I believe Tyler's in control of this match. Getting his arms pretty deep there, doing a lot of reaching. That's something we'll have to work on, but there again, drove to a nice nice front headlock to a far knee pick, and got some back points out of that. Right there at the buzzer, got two takedown, three near falls. So Tyler's done a nice job for us this year.
I believe the score after the first period was 7-1. If Tyler has a weakness wrestling on the bottom, I believe it is exactly what you just saw right there. He gives up his arms pretty easily when he's on bottom. If he were to take any suggestions from me, that's what I would suggest, is to keep those elbows tight to his legs and not give those up.
Well, and you saw that with Ben's match too. They just I don't know why bottom wrestling has been our Achilles heels. We work hard on it. You know, our top wrestling, I was talking to this with my wife Kelly the other night, our top wrestling is as good as I've ever seen it, and we never work on our top wrestling in practice. I mean, we literally might spend 30 minutes to an hour a week working on our top wrestling. But we are tough on top, but on bottom, we work on our feet and on bottom all the time, and we struggle. And I think I don't know if it's the concept that they don't understand or if it's a mindset, you know, I know our kids, I've seen them be tough and get off bottom, so I don't know what holds them back, but, you know, obviously it's something we're going to have to really continue to work on, and I think it's just the concept of understanding the position you need to put yourself in to be able to get away. And like you said, with Tyler, he gives up his arms too much, and that's because he's got way too much space between his knees and his elbows. I mean, he's got to learn to wrestle more in a balled position, and same thing with Ben, and we've got some other guys, Justin Schroeder, Cole Dowd, Josh Heckathorn. We've got some other guys who need to do that as well. So,
West Central made a huge mistake right there. You saw him flip over backwards thinking he was going to be able to roll Tyler all the way through, and Tyler, too experienced for that, and actually was able to get a reversal and a little bit of near fall there. So, again, he increases his lead even more going into what will be the third period here soon. we talk about, our Achilles heels, where we may not be strong as a team, but I think this is one of our better takedown teams that we've ever had. Mm-hmm. And our guys don't go out there and flaunt it, I guess, is what is the word I'm looking for here.
Right.
They do have quite a few takedowns for the season, but they're not breaking any school records because they just go out and get it done. They get the takedown mm-hmm. they need, and again, we're good on top, so we can turn the opponents quite often. But when it comes down to it in a match, I feel very confident that our boys can get it done when you need that takedown at the end of a match against an opponent.
Well, and they've done a nice job of, like you said, they don't really flaunt it. And I, as a coach, I could push that probably a lot more to get more takedowns. I mean, as a team, we probably could have had another 150, 200 takedowns.
Easily.
But that's just not something that, we do. And we've done that in the past, I think, with other teams, but just not with this team. And we've been focused on our goals this year were to win a conference, win a sectional, and make it to team state. So right now we're getting there. Tyler just picked up a nice fall there for us at 160 pounds. We're going to give up a forfeit here at 170 pounds. Garrett Shane got hurt earlier in the day and wasn't able to wrestle any more matches. And then Taylor Pugh's going to wrestle at 182. And he'll come out here in just 1 second. Tyler did a nice job of really taking it to that kid there at the end and picking up a nice fall for us.
That puts the team score right now 39-21. I want to correct that. That actually the team score is 39-24 going into this final match of the day. And Rochester has already sealed the victory. I mean, if Taylor gets pinned here, he will only give up 16 points, which would make it 39-30. So we've already actually got this dual one. We've got the championship sewed up for the Super 8. Nice another little trophy for the guys this year, working hard, deserving some victories like this. And it's a good warm-up for conference, see where we're going to stand. As this match progresses, West Central got a takedown there and was up 2-0, got a leg in as Taylor stands up, and referee starts it for potentially dangerous, exposing both wrestlers to, if they go back to the mat hard, they don't really have a way to protect themselves going back down. But a couple things I want to say is stay tuned to Channel 4 as Coach Gard and myself are going to prepare the conference that we just had after a snow delay, weather delay, and having that, we will also have this airing for you guys here in the very near future. Taylor was able to get up and get away there. The score is now 2-1.
And again, this kid, I don't think this kid's real experienced, but he's got more experience than Taylor does. And Taylor's doing a nice job here of of staying with this kid. He really wrestled pretty well, especially in this first period. He's got to do a better job here of pushing the head down, cross-facing, something. He's not getting that head down or out of there the way he should. And he's doing a good job of sticking with it and trying to turn a corner, but just not enough experience there.
Yeah, so his hips to the side, but they ran out of time.
No takedown. Scores 2-1.
I wanted to mention again that wrestling here against West Central. They were a third place team in that single A division, and the Coaches Association not being 100%. They went through a little bit of the flu bug. I'm not sure if I mentioned that earlier when we were talking about this. And they were missing like two or three guys from their lineup, and their coach felt that they could have actually placed a little bit higher if they were at full strength, which they are today against the Zebras. And as you can see, they're giving them, you know, giving the Zebras a fairly good go today, which is exactly what we wanted to have. We needed a little bit of competition to get these guys ready for conference and then going into sectionals against a very tough Plymouth team. And the same move that John Hunting got on the Clinton Central wrestler, the West Central wrestler got on Taylor here and got the fall.
Well, it's a little bit different. That's more of a banana split.
That's true.
But you do kind of end up in the same position. Though, as you can see there, Taylor's a little bit hurt. That banana split, if used properly and let go a little bit, can really stretch you. And that's what happens there. It hurts pretty bad. So Taylor did a nice job in that match. He, you know, again, he's filled in for us nicely this year and done a real nice job. I've been real happy with him.
Well, I'm Chad Morgan, along with Clint Gard. We appreciate you guys watching us today, and stay tuned for further Rochester wrestling events.